Before TikTok, Spotify, YouTube, and even MySpace, there was really only one way for musicians to broadcast their craft to an audience larger than whatever bar or laundromat they happened to be performing in, and that was to cut a single and get it played on the radio. This raises the question, how do radio stations decide which songs to play? The answer is too complex to get into complete detail, but there are a few obvious methods. Stations look at what is popular on the Billboard charts, they survey listeners, and of course, they take promotional material from bigwig record labels who've got money to throw around. Trouble with these methods is they'll never give a station the edge over any other radio station. If Sun Records dropped off the new Elvis Presley single for one station, then you can bet they did the same for every other station they're competing with. So, to stay ahead in the radio biz, enterprising music directors and DJs turn to a regular music industry publication, Friday Morning Quarterback, to get the insights of American DJ, wrestling TV commentator, and philanthropist Cal Rudman. It may seem ridiculous to suggest that one man could have so much sway over popular music in America, but if you've ever heard of Devo, the surreal, energy dome-wearing new wave band, then you have Rudman to thank. After a disappointing second studio album, Devo was looking to come back with the same wild energy that had made their first album a success. The first single, off their third studio album, didn't get much traction in the charts, and the record label wasn't too confident about their second single taking off due to its unusual rhythm and odd lyrics. The record label was right. The single didn't do much for the band, and the album's release was met with little acclaim. Despite this apparent failure, Devo set out on tour, booking what small venues they could. Unbeknownst to the band, Rudman was rallying for their quirky single in the southeastern part of the states. Rudman had taken a liking to the group's work and was promoting it heavily through his station and publication. From the southeastern states to the entire country and then the world at large, Rudman single-handedly changed the fate of Devo and their tour. Within a week of Rudman's campaigning, Devo's popularity grew so rapidly that they were forced to put their tour on hold so they could book larger venues to accommodate their rapidly growing fan base. What is this song that moved the mind of one of the most influential American disc jockeys? Well, it's a weird, electronic-focused piece with lyrics that are either meant to satirize American optimism or serve as pep talk for former President Jimmy Carter, depending on whether you ask Jerry Casale or Mark Mothersbaugh. Either way, it's a cracking good song. Oh, that's right, we're talking about Devo's Whip It on Cover Me. Crash and whip. Give the pass a slip. Step on the grip. Break your mama's back. When a problem comes along. That's right, it's Cover Me, the only podcast that compares famous songs to their many cover versions to find out which one broke your mama's back. I'm your host, as always, The Snake, joined by my creamy co-host,
Alex Mildenberger.
Alex Mildenberger, what's going on?
Good things. Good things are going on.
Oh, good things.
Good things, yes. Things are going, I saw some live music this week.
Live music.
Feeling good about that. That was a cool thing.
Any covers? Any covers to report?
Not that I noticed, no.
Did anybody shout for the bands to play Freebird?
No, we're still kind of getting back into it, you know, so even right. the band that was playing said, like, this is our first show in 2 years.
Okay. So did they point out a guy in the audience and say, you bring him here? I've been wanting to do this for a long time. And then they poured a beer on his head. Did that happen?
I left a bit early, so okay. It's possible, but it was like very chill music. So I feel like they wouldn't do.
Did you leave? Cause they were pointing at you.
Yeah, I was scared they'd pour a beer on my head, and I said, that is too much. No, I left because it was a weeknight, and I had to get up to work the next morning.
School night.
Yeah, school night.
Well, that's excellent, Alex. Love a bit of live music. Did you like the bands, or did you just like seeing live music?
I honestly don't know, but I did enjoy myself, yeah.
That's good. That's excellent, Alex. I'm glad to hear that. Tell me this, though. What's life like living with a theremin?
It's not so different, but this week is just like me trying to tell as many people as I possibly can. So I'm like, hey, I made this thing. It's very cool, and I want you to know. Got some knobs. Courtesy of Will, friend of the podcast and roommate.
Hey, if you want some knobs made, contact Will.
He makes knobs. Yeah,
they freelance like 3D knobber.
The knob part, and then also made some metal like inserts for cymbals, so like that indicate what the knobs are for.
Mm-hmm.
Like there's a little like loudspeaker symbol for volume and like a sunburst for brightness and stuff like that.
Yeah, looks pretty fucking slick.
Yeah. That's what's been going on with me. What's been going on with you?
I just live in the dream in rainy Vancouver.
Nice and rainy. Wait, that's nice.
Nice and rainy. You know, snow. Wake up, go to work. I guess it's snow out there. That's not surprising.
No, it's not.
Gotta love Calgary snow. Did it stick around a long time or is it gone?
No, it's all gone. We're good now.
It's all gone. Well, that's fantastic, Alex. I'll tell you what, not a lot of news on my end, but there is Cover Me news. Cover Me news. Alex, we got our first episode suggestion from a stranger.
Oh. Getting episode suggestion. Now.
Yeah, two interactions in the course of like as many weeks.
Okay.
Maybe a lot more weeks. I don't know. I can't remember when the same other person. Thing happened. No, a different person.
Oh, okay.
Two different people, Alex.
All right.
And I'll tell you, I won't tell the audience here, so we'll bleep this out, but the request is...
I'm sure that'd be a good one.
Yeah, sounds good to me, man. We're going to make it so.
Yeah.
I think.
I would want to. Also.
You fucking would want to. That's what's new in Cover Me news. Alex, today we're talking about a hit song from the year 1980, a song I've known since I was a baby, probably very young. I think this was on the first CD I burned. I used to listen to this a lot. Whip It by Devo. Alex. Whip It by Devo.
Devo.
Short for Devolution.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
Me neither.
I don't know what I thought. It's a band I've always known the name of, but almost never known... Like their actual music, obviously.
Yeah, sometimes
song.
Considered a one-hit wonder because just this song being so widely popular.
But like they had, I only know their music from like Rock Band.
Pretty much. That checks out.
I've heard it in other places, and this song was a weird one because before I'd ever heard it, I had heard people sing it or reference it,
right?
And say like whip it in good shape. Or whatever. Sometimes shape it up. The other words, but mostly just
get
it whip
straight.
It.
Go forward.
And
move
just,
ahead,
like, didn't know the song for a long time, but knew some of the words.
Yeah. It's it's just a song that has existed and will forever exist. So bizarre, so strange. Only made it into the popular conscience because one guy said, hey, I like this, and I happen to be an influential radio DJ.
Yeah, that second part definitely helped.
Yeah. Ugh.
But, and they're an interesting group.
They are insane.
For, like, several reasons. Obviously, there's, like, Mark Mothersbaugh, who does a lot of soundtrack work.
Yeah. They're comprised of two sets of brothers.
Yeah.
The original lineup, anyhow. It's the Casales and the Mothersbaughs.
Mothersbaugh.
And this is a crazy one. Their whole thing is crazy. So I want to point out that afterwards, and I didn't include, so there's a group called Devo 2.0.
Okay.
Which is a Walt Disney Records band that was put, so it's like teenagers. It was meant to emulate the success of Swedish pop group, the A-Teens. And Jerry Casale, it is Jerry, right? Yeah. Jerry Casale of Devo. Was put on, he's like, he decided to manage the band, Devo 2.0, because of him and his band's firm belief in the devolution of humanity. He was like, yeah, it only makes sense that Devo would eventually get, you know, recycled into this worse trash version. So he was like, yeah, I'll take that on and turn my previous career into a new garbage product.
That's such a strange thing. Be like, yeah, that checks out philosophically. All right, let's fuck this up.
Yeah. To be like, yeah.
It was inevitable. Shit. We're just saying it was happening, not that it, like, not trying to stop it necessarily. Or
yeah, exactly. It. It's so just to be like, yeah, I'm gonna do that. Fuck it. It's gonna happen. If I don't do it, somebody else is gonna do it. So it might as well be me.
I've heard that was a big part of why the recent Matrix, fourth Matrix movie got made.
Oh, that makes sense too.
Yeah. But I haven't seen that movie yet. So
Nor have I. I was going to watch all the trilogy, but only the second two are on Netflix, and I don't feel like paying money. I mean, I have The Matrix on UMD for the PlayStation Portable.
Watch it on your PSP, yeah.
Yeah, it's not the best option, but I mean, I'll do it if I have to. So this is Whip It. What else did I have to say about these guys? The energy domes. Let's talk about the energy domes, Alex.
Yeah, well, I guess you got to talk about the energy domes.
You got to talk about the energy domes. AKA so they didn't always Devo wear hats. Yeah, the Devo hats, the energy domes, the ziggurats that they place upon their domes. A quote from Mother's Body says, "We designed them, Jerry and I," that's Jerry Casale, "we were influenced both by German Bauhaus movement and geometric fashion and Aztec temples. We just liked the look. It looked good and didn't look like any other bands out there. We weren't interested in wearing groovy hats or groovy clothing. We kind of looked like Lego toys or something by the time we got those on our heads. That was a positive thing." So they make these weird hats. And then there is a weird... So they're meant to like redirect energy that escapes your head back into your body. And they have directions printed for how to wear the hats properly. You're supposed to have like a liner on the inside or something that pushes the dome up a bit so it's not directly in contact with your head. Otherwise, it won't redirect energy. So this is, again, they're doing this, like, kind of tongue-in-cheek, but also it has the same vibe as Casale being like, yeah, I'll manage this fucking garbage band.
Yeah, like, we'll put out some, like, ridiculous information, because we know people are just, like, gonna believe it or something. Yeah. Or, yeah, there's definitely, like, some irony and, like, sarcasm going on, but they, like, really run with it.
Yeah, they really do, and so they are very much like, we'll run with it, guys, because this song, apparently, people thought it was about masturbation or, like, sadomasochism, you know, mm-hmm. little BDSM scene, and they were just like, hey, that's gonna sell fucking single, sure, we'll do, like, we'll let people go along with it. They later come out and say that, oh, it's about, like, satirizing American optimism, or in Mother Ba's eyes... It was pep talk for Jimmy Carter, who was up against, I think, Reagan.
Yeah, it was Ronald Reagan.
Yeah.
In 1980. So, yeah, for Carter's potential second term, which, as we know now, didn't happen.
Didn't happen, yeah. Because he failed to whip it into shape.
Yeah. Which, it's so weird to be like, yeah, we were satirizing it, but also, like, it was kind of a pep talk. So, like, and, like, that, I guess, kind of makes sense because, like, It's the president of the United States of America, right? Like, that is such an embodiment of, like, the idea of the United States, the president. And then they're using this, like, ironic version of, like, this you can do it pep talk to not only be like, yeah, you can do it, buddy, but also legitimately say, yeah, you can do it, buddy. It is like...
And to be like, yeah, we're some band from Akron, Ohio, and we're going to encourage the president. It's insane, right? And to encourage him with what is, like, bizarre, weird, empty platitudes that don't really mean anything. Like, the song is like a collection of one phrase that you could just plaster on motivational posters, right? You got the cat hanging on. Instead of saying hang in there, it just says whip it.
Yeah.
Let's talk about these lyrics.
Something about whipped cream. Put whipped cream in.
Yeah, we get also the predecessor to the, like, the drop it like it's hot kind of song, where it's different scenarios in which you must whip it, or different scenarios in which you must drop it like it's hot.
Yeah, just like arbitrarily.
Yeah. So here's the lyrics. Let's get into these. Crack that whip. Give the past a slip. Step on a crack. Break your mama's back. So here we're introduced to the concept of whips.
Yeah, whips are gonna come up a lot in this song.
How do we even analyze this, Alex?
I was struggling coming into this, and I'm struggling now. I mean, I guess we'll say, like, on the surface, yeah, it definitely has that, like, kind of emptiness, like saying, like, don't worry about what happened before, but then, like, step on a crack, break your mama's back, like, what the fuck? Is that positive?
Yeah, is that positive? Is that just, like, some weird superstition element that seems to, or is it just to, like, be,
I mean, they've already kind of decided like, oh, we're going to talk about whipping things in different ways. But this one's actually like, oh, we're actually cracking things in different ways. Like different kinds of cracks.
Crack that whip, step on a crack.
Yeah. So it's like,
break your mom's back.
I don't know. It just feels like kind of wordplay for its own sake.
Right. So you need to be on like the right of, like, side the of the crack.
I don't know.
Yeah, that it is like, it's nonsense. Crack that whip, step on a crack. It's like nursery rhyme, sort of like sing song. Here's some words loosely related.
Yeah, like I struggled to get anything more out of it. There's also like the, apparently it was inspired by Gravity's Rainbow, which I have not read. Have you read Gravity's Rainbow?
Ah, yes, Thomas Pynchon's Gravity's Rainbow. No, I put it on my, I put it on hold on the library this week because I was like, yeah, I should give that a
probably
read.
Probably good move because I was thinking about checking it out because of this as well. Which is a satirical novel that describes humanity's evolution as regressive and perhaps lacking self-awareness, which is like, hey, that's what the band name is, right? That's the Devolution.
Yeah, it seems like a book written for Devo.
So what's also weird, like I was reading another, I don't have the specific quote, but they said like, you know, this is like our popular song. And like, that's cool because it's a song that's like, it's not like worse than our other songs. Like it's another song we do. So it's nice that it got popular kind of thing. But like, it almost feels like, in a way, just because it's based on around that idea, like, doesn't that make this kind of like their signature song, even not counting its popularity?
I don't know. It seems like it would be a real, hey, what's Devo about? It's like, well, it's this. It's about whip it.
Yeah, it's about whipping it.
Yeah. And then, not about whip it, like huffing. Like, you know, nitrous.
NO2, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. But about whipping it. Also never knew the line was give the past a slip. I didn't know what the fuck it was.
No, there's a lot of not knowing the words. But kind of like there's not actually that many different words. I kind of thought I didn't know much of this song, but it turns out I did. It's just,
yeah, it turns out I knew most of it.
Yeah. But what else happens? Another part, I guess a verse.
Yeah.
When a goblin comes along, you must whip it before the cream sets out too long. You must whip it when something's going wrong. You must whip it. It's just things you gotta whip.
Yeah, things in scenario, and two of them are the same. A problem and when something's wrong are the same scenario.
It's the same thing. So yeah, there's like a redundancy in this song, and it's like nonsensical. What does that have to do with like the cream? Like, Don't let the cream go bad. You got to turn into whipped cream. I guess, but also like I'm pretty sure whipping cream doesn't make it last longer either. Like, what does it have to do with it being out long? It's just a rhyme.
Yeah, like if you set cream out too long,
you
want to
whip it before it goes bad, I guess. But
yeah, I guess
you don't like leave it out after that or anything.
Yeah, well, according to Genius, he says society encourages conflict to be answered with immediate violence. This annotation is unreviewed because it is unhinged. I don't think that's what, but there may be something about the like the catch-all approach to American society.
Yeah, I wonder it is like. Sorry, I interrupted.
No, sorry. Yeah, where it's like one solution fits all problems. The solution is whipping it, which sure is a violent act, but can be applied to cream as well as other things.
Right. It's like if you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail, kind of thing.
Yeah. Or
like if you have a whip, everything looks like cream, something like that. but also, I mean, to an extent, to me, the idea of whipped cream is a bit of a symbol of like the like 1950s family unit thing. Does that make sense? Mm.
Yeah, you even get that in the music video. It is like a 1950s housewife literally whipping up a big thing of cream.
Yeah. So like there's a bit of that there too, of like this idealism of the past kind of thing. Maybe that would be more like Cool Whip. No, I'm probably making that up. But like having the whipped cream on your pancakes that the housewife is whipping up, and it's only like a small part of that image, but it does, I think, evoke that a little bit.
Yeah, I would agree to that. There because, is something, you know, yeah, whipped cream just seems American to me. Ultimately.
Yeah, which is maybe a weird, but I don't know.
Yeah, you can whip cream anywhere, but that's like, it's sort of decadent, and there's that like decadent sweetness that is like kind of very particular to American desserts.
And it's mostly air, I guess, at the end of the day.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. There's technically not a lot of substance to it.
Yeah.
So that's your first verse. Then we get what's either a chorus or a refrain here. Now whip it into shape. Shape it up. Get it straight. Go forward. Move ahead. Try to detect it. It's not too late to whip it. Whip it good.
And this part feels more to me like that straight, like, pep talk thing.
Mm-hmm.
But perhaps with maybe the fact that it's just kind of a bunch of words. Like, not necessarily saying anything, just like, you can do it.
Yeah, it connects to that idea of give the past a slip as well, I suppose. Go straight, go forward, move ahead.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and also, like, working out. Like, whip it into shape, shape it up.
Go for it, yeah. Kind of don't, you know, fuck the haters.
Yeah.
Keep it moving.
The one that doesn't, like, even it's not too late makes sense to me. It's like, it's keep going. That's just another version of go forward, really.
I guess so. It's not necessarily nonsensical at this point. It makes sense. Like, the phrasing all makes sense.
Yeah, except for try to detect it.
Oh, yeah. Try to detect it, which is a weird way to say it. And I don't necessarily know what they mean. But,
yeah, detect, I mean, what?
I get,
is, like, this specifically for Jimmy Carter? It was like,
yeah,
try to get in on what Ronald Reagan's scheme is, or is like whatever it may be.
Like the problem, because like the whole point here is like there's something going wrong, but like don't give up hope. It's like, so when you're detecting it, you're just like analyzing your surroundings or whatever, and like solve the problem. It's not too late. Yeah. You can whip whatever it is that's in your way. Like find it and whip it.
Yeah, it's like almost like a hunter ideology, which again seems like Americanism, like yeehaw, I'm gonna find it, I'm gonna whip it, and then it's gonna be good. Like,
yeah.
So yeah, move ahead, try to detect it. That does sound like hunting a bit.
If you're detecting things, yeah, I guess so.
Yeah, like, yeah, that's a bit of a stretch, but
I mean, I've been stretching this whole time. I don't know about you.
Yeah, I mean, honestly,
did you hear all that?
Nobody's
stuff
gonna come away from. Yes, that was a good first year essay about whipped cream and Devo's Whip It. But yeah, that's what we got to do here, because I mean I already read the two lines that sum up what they were thinking. Otherwise, it does sound like a collection of positive strange platitudes.
Yeah, and I mean that also fits in with like the vibe of the band just being kind of like a bunch of weirdos.
Yeah,
I mean, have you seen their hats?
I have seen their hats, Alex. I know a little bit about them. Energy domes. Maybe we should wear energy domes for like a week and see how we feel.
See what happens. See if we've... Well, looking at the Wikipedia page for energy domes, there is a description that mentions orgone energy.
Ah, oh, yes.
Which was like kind of a big thing in the 50s. And you can still buy orgonite, which is like resin with metal in it.
Right.
But you may recall, and I don't remember who everyone is, but there is an orgone like collector room in one part of On the Road. I don't remember. Is it like William S. Burroughs or something?
Maybe.
Is that the right that it's supposed to be? No, that can't be right, can it?
You're thinking of like shit. I should know who this is.
Anyway, I don't remember who it's supposed to be because I didn't read the version of the book that has the real names in it. But they like visit his like acreage and sit in his orgone chamber.
Right.
But I think orgone energy is supposed to be like sexual energy. So what I'm saying is, if we wear the hats, we'll just get really horny.
Okay, and then also, so you're not only wearing an energy dome, but you might give energy dome.
Yeah, you might. Yeah, you might also give it to someone else. This one says if you wear an energy dome, it recycles the energy. But yeah, you might be able to transfer it. I don't know. I mean, we won't know unless we try.
Yeah, we might have to order a couple energy domes, get them rigged up right. You could probably 3D print an energy dome.
Probably. I think
it's a pretty simple design.
Will's printer's big enough, but...
Yeah.
Should be possible.
Something to think about, people. But enough about energy domes. Let's talk about whipping it.
Whatever.
So we come to what one could construe as verse 2, verse 3, maybe.
What I would probably call verse 2, but it's a little ambiguous.
It's a little ambiguous. When a good time turns around, you must whip it. You will never live it down unless you whip it. No one gets away until they whip it. That you gotta whip it.
Did these annotations on Genius really, really thinks this song is like about government violence?
Yeah.
Which I didn't really get personally.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like a protest song. I don't feel like we're doing a euphemism here.
Though, I mean, it fits in maybe as much as anything else, just as one of the various themes that come up in that, like, oh, we're talking about whipping our problems. So yes, in a way, we're talking about solving our problems with violence.
Yeah, or at least with blunt solutions, or like the one thing fits all. It seems to be, to me, to be more about American single-mindedness.
Than, which, like, violence specifically.
Than violence specifically, yeah. Which I think violence plays into that, but I don't feel like this was, that they got together and were like, this is a song about violence. The government, right. They've gone too far. You gotta whip it. Gotta like, whip that doesn't read to me.
Fight fire with
but
fire.
Yeah, it's interesting, because it's like the solution to things turning bad is whipping it. And if you don't whip it, you're never going to live it down, so you have to whip it. And not only you, everyone else has to whip. Yeah. We all have to whip
to all of life's problems.
this cult-like behavior. So yeah, it is about just like American, like weird cult-like ideology towards go-getterism, maybe? Whipping it?
Yeah, maybe. I mean, the answer to all of our questions here is, yeah, maybe.
Yeah, maybe. It's a whole lot of yeah, maybe. If you guys were coming to here hoping to crack whip it open, I'm sorry. I say whip it.
We whip can it only good. Crack the whip. We can't crack it open.
Yeah, listen. We're about to give the past a slip, because I think we're running out of lyrics here.
Yep.
The only other part is I say whip it good. I say whip it good, which I... Whip it.
Let's whip it.
Fucking whip it. I guess it's also worth mentioning here, just because it came to my brain, but a lot of ads have used whip it, which again, Devo has been totally and completely behind, even re-singing some lyrics for, I think, the Swiffer commercial, where it's like, you must Swiffer. And again, because they're like, well, this is always how it's going to go down. It's like, so for them to see the decay of something that I don't think they didn't build it to be a commercial enterprise as much as they are like working musicians, but they take this great joy in watching like mold grow over the bread of what their bread, like, yeah, it's
such a strange position to be like, I fucking told you, this is exactly what I said was gonna happen and you did it. Like, I'm just sit back and be like, yeah, I was right, which is, yeah. Sounds kind of depressing to me, but I mean, yeah.
Yeah, to see these dudes delight in it is strange, weird. Like, it's just... Devo, man, they're strange guys, and I like it.
Yeah.
I also like the name of their first album. Q, Are We Men? A, We Are Devo. That's fun.
That is a good name.
That's the lyrics to this, though. After that, we get a repetition to crack that whip when a problem comes along, and then whip it into shape, shape it up, get it straight, go forward, move ahead, try to detect it. It's not too late to whip it good. A strange song for strange times. It's really ushering in the 80s. This is May 14th, 1980, this came out.
Yeah, I mean, they definitely have, like, that, what would become the kind of, like, 80s weirdo thing going on. And obviously there's some inspiration from like earlier, I guess, what would be, I want to say kraut rock, but I don't know the definition that well, but I mean there's definitely some of them that makes me think of like Kraftwerk.
In fact, the rhythm of this is called a motoric rhythm. I might be saying that wrong, because this is of course a German word, which is like a 4-4 rhythm, but it's very specific to krautrock and German styles of music.
Yeah, which underlies just like this whole thing.
Mm-hmm. These guys are a real like American version of European trends, both in terms of your krautrock, your synth work, and of course new wave, which was, I think, bigger in the UK before it ever really, you know, settled in America.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, these guys are fucking weirdos. Even the creation of the music, which we're about to get into, is weird. Because essentially, Mark Mothersbaugh seemed to be in charge of the music half. It seems to me Jerry Casale was more in charge of the lyrics, though I imagine there was crossover on both ends.
Right.
He basically compiled it from four different demo tracks that he had recorded. The music for Whip Out, this is a quote, was crafted by taking elements from four different demo tapes that Casale had collected. Okay, he collected them. Mothersbaugh composed what became the song's break in his bedroom. The break was originally much slower and had a classical sound. On another tape, Mothersbaugh played what became the main riff with a drum machine. One of Captain Beefheart's drummers created a beat that Mothersbaugh recorded. The last demo was a live recording between Casale and Mothersbaugh. Casale took the four demos and layered them to create a smooth, consistent time signature.
Yeah, which is, I mean, kind of a cool thing to be like, hey, we have these four different things. Let's put them all in the same, like tempo and just make them all one song.
Yeah. And then they also lift that main riff by just chopping off the end of the riff in Roy Orbison's Oh Pretty Woman.
Right. Yes. I like that quote where he's like, oh, it was that, you know, the thing you were playing before? He's like, oh, yeah, the thing that's just Pretty Woman with the end cut off? Like, oh, yeah, let's use that. And like,
yeah. So this song is like a Frankenstein experiment of random demos and samples. It's... like, we talked about Old Town Road a couple of weeks back, and as emblematic as that song is of the modern music-making machine, this Devo's 1980 piece seems to in some way be emblematic of the sort of new wave of strange thinking, and like, the future is now kind of, we're splicing things together, we're using electronic machinery. It seems like a real ushering in of the 1980s era of music thought.
Yeah, and moving into, yeah, like you said, a more electronic focus, and even like their attitudes towards a lot of this, like just like how like sarcastic and ironic they are, the kind of things that you do get a lot in I guess new wave in particular.
Mm-hmm.
And like even the way they sing, it's kind of disjointed and weird, and that, yeah, that happens a ton in new wave, like that.
Yeah, hilarious. I mean,
this was a couple years after Talking Heads 77, but like, you know, there's some David Byrne.
Oh, for sure.
Similar ideas how David Byrne sings. I'm not gonna I suspect is more a case of them just like having similar influences than.
Yeah, David Byrne, I think B-52s is also
oh, yes, comparable. Absolutely.
Yeah, and of the same time.
So,
and I think another American band, B-52s. So it was like them and Devo holding down the new wave front in America. Now, I had one more thing I wanted to mention on that. Oh, they said they compared it to, they called it white dudes rapping.
Did Devo call it that?
Yeah, they said, it's kind of like white boys rapping. So they do a call and response. And while I disagree that it sounds like rap, it does also sound like, for 1980s, what white people would understand rap as.
And also, like, in 1980, like, we talked about old rap. It, like, doesn't sound like rap now. Like, it's very different.
Oh, yeah, we're about to talk about some rap this episode that doesn't sound like rap today.
But
let's talk about this song in the nitty-gritty. We've talked about the broad strokes. So it's freaking Whip It. You guys ever heard this song?
Yeah, you guys heard Whip It. So the beat first. That's the like motoric or motoric, whatever. yeah, a lot of that cymbal, and then just kind of boom ta going between the snare and like the bass. So it's like pretty simple. Just kind of does
simple,
that for a long time.
Energetic right off the bat.
And then a lot of this song is like different calls and responses.
Yes.
So like that's how I feel about like the kind of main riff, which is that half of Pretty Woman followed by the bah, like descending. So it's ascending on the bass and then descending on like the lead kind of synth sound. And that's kind of your call and response there. And then once they come in with the lyrics, that's kind of another call and response that's kind of at like half time compared to that, because they're only singing during the descending synth line.
That's right.
But then the call and the response are both in that part. So it's like two different call and response parts that are just happening slightly different times.
Yeah.
And then once they actually get into like the verse, which is after the whatever the intro thing is, it's they kind of then speed that up again and they just do back and forth instead of
wait. Yeah. And then of course even the guitar is joining in on that call and response with the no problem comes along in there. You must wear it. Yeah, it is like a whole call and response machine. So you got a whole bunch of... So they used API mixing consoles on this, 3M tape machines, Mini Moog, Prophet 5 synthesizers. There's whip crack noises in it that use an Electrocomp 500 synthesizer. So a lot of like fucking tech of the time built to make this call and response energy piece.
Yeah, I mean, Prophet 5 in 1980, like, of course. Yeah,
that's the time for Prophet 5. Next big change is like the alternating synth in the what one might call the chorus. Now whip it into shape. And it's just a half step.
Two. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's going between two notes. Even the chorus is kind of a call and response too.
Mm-hmm.
It's lyrics. Bum bum bum. Dun dun bum bum bum. Bum bum.
Go forward.
So it's move ahead. It's not necessarily like specifically like the call and response thing. Like definitely like back and forth between two parts where we do part, you know?
Yeah. Is it like the musical equivalent of whipping us, like whipping our attention kind of back and forth?
Back and forth. Yeah, maybe. I mean, I'm actually surprised that they didn't do more like
left and right stuff.
Pan right hard.
Because you really could just honestly split this song down the middle and then have one half in the left and one half in the right.
It does feel like that, yeah. But there's just so much of that going on.
And a shape. Shape it up. Those are kind of the big parts, because it is very consistent. It's a 2 minutes, 40 second song. I guess the, what like might be the refrain. Section. Yeah, the boom, down, down. Are you talking about a different part?
Nope, that's what I was talking about.
Yeah, I say whip it. Bump, bum, dump, whip it good.
Which is really just, I mean, for in terms of like recognizable parts of the song, it's probably like ba-na-na-na-na, da, da, and then whip it good. Like it's, those kind of your hooks, I guess.
Yeah. And so we run through that a couple times. Whip it good, man. Whip it real good.
And, like, it's mostly a loop after that. There's kind of an instrumental section to split things in half.
Yeah.
Where the bass, like, it's a bit different. There's the climbing bass line, but then it also descends.
Right. Dun, dun, dun.
Bum, and then just, like, a single synth, dun, 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 dun. Like, note yeah. or chord playing. And, okay, this part was a little bit weird in terms of the timing. Because I swear, once mm-hmm. we get to this section, the actual pattern is repeating every, like, six beats. Instead,
oh, like you're the, saying this is a 6-4 rhythm.
I don't know. Like the drums, like the beat is still the same.
I can tell you this, Alex. The instrumental break, according to Wikipedia, reconfigures the riff to a 6-4 beat for a bit.
Huh, there you go. Yeah. I couldn't find anything that said that. I was like Googling it, but I just needed to read further in the Wikipedia page.
Okay. Yeah, that's all you need to do.
Oh, man.
I just wrote that down. I was like, yeah, it won't come up. And then here we are. So
I was like, this doesn't match up. I was like trying to count it out. And I was like, wait a minute. Does the whole song do this? And it doesn't.
But it doesn't. No. Does. Yeah, there is like a sort of like keeping the listener off balance is seems to be part of the intent of this song. Both that like alternating synth that bah, 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 is unsettling. You get the change in like the rhythm, the 6-4 instead of a 4-4. You get the call and response constantly. Like, it's
constantly
a lot of it is
back and forth, yeah.
Yeah, it's very non-traditional. I understand why the record label is like, this is never going to fucking work. What is going on with this song?
Yeah, and yet, I mean, it did.
And did, and it survives, like people today still know Whip It.
Yeah, and like I said, like, know the song without necessarily knowing the song, you know?
Yeah, like, the pop culture around it.
Without having ever heard it.
Yeah, huge stuff. And that's kind of the big beats, because at the end we get that instrumental break again that kind of takes us out of the song.
Mm-hmm. And, yeah. That's the song.
That is the song, isn't it?
Song. Feels like it jumps around a lot, but which makes sense because A, how it's written, there's a lot of back and forth. And yeah. There's like, I mean, it was literally stitched together from a bunch of different like songs or ideas at least.
Mm-hmm.
So kind of makes sense that it is like that. It creates a very interesting feeling when listening to it. And then on top of that, they're like very strange delivery.
Yeah.
Which is less strange now, but it's still strange.
Still strange for the time, and you still don't hear like we'll hear versions later today that kind of have their like weird take on it, but it's not it's just not the same.
Yeah, it's not this, that's for sure.
It's a little, we talked about with Velvet Underground how people try to do the Velvet Underground, but it's like too palatable now. Like right. It's like there's a little too much like music theory behind it or something, like it's not put through that avant-garde filter, so it doesn't hit the same. And there's maybe the same thing going on with Devo.
Of like they were just doing their thing, and now their thing has become like we put a label on it. So someone's like, yeah. Oh, I want to do kind of a new wave thing, but they're doing it to do a new wave thing. They're not doing it like necessarily as like a direct, honest expression. Not necessarily that it's dishonest to do things that way, but it's not the same. And I mean, that's the sort of thing you get like when, oh, I don't know, like a new team of writers takes over a show or something, you know? Like, they are not coming from the same place. They're coming from a place of trying to be like what it was before, which is very different from, hey, I have this idea, and it turns into that thing. But if the thing is where you're starting, then you end up at a different place.
Exactly. It is. Those words make sense? It does make sense. Yeah, it's the difference between, you know, exploring new territory and then going to where somebody else has been. And, you know, trying to build on that, it can be done, but it's maybe more difficult. It's easier to find something new.
It's a different job, but
it's a different job.
But yeah, it brings you somewhere different.
Brings you somewhere different. And on that note, we're going to move differently into the music video. So Devo is also known for being into music videos kind of ahead of them taking off. Music videos naturally have a long tradition dating back to like 1890 when a guy set music to a magic lantern. So those ones you like fucking spin and they have the image, like the image reel in there.
Yeah. What are they? Starts with a Z, I think.
Maybe.
I'll shout it out later.
Zoetrope. It. Yes.
I don't know if it counts as zoetrope, but it's that kind of idea.
Yeah, it's that kind of idea. So they stem back to that time, and we talked about the Beatles and their promo videos. I was looking at the history today because I was going to write an intro kind of based around that concept, but it's so fucking dense. Like, so there's a big history of people making short films and stuff, but the sort of commercialization of it and the real focus of it as something musicians did was around the MTV time.
Yeah, which started in, I think, 1980?
That's right. So Devo already had a handful of music videos just in the can. They had just made them. And thus, when MTV was starting up, they're like, well, we need material to run on our TV station that runs all fucking day. Devo's like, here, we got a handful. Like, take these off our hands. And one of those was the bizarre and eventually ruled misogynistic for reasons that are pretty obvious. But again, this is a Devo situation, so you got to figure out what Devo is doing here.
Yeah.
Based it on an issue, a 1962 issue of The Dude magazine.
The Dude magazine. Dude magazine. Look that up, because I didn't look up the magazine.
I didn't look up the magazine itself, but they talk about the article it was based on. Okay. So it was about a former stuntman who marries a stripper and moves to a dude ranch in Arizona. For entertainment, the man would use a whip to remove the clothes from his wife, who would remain unhurt. Mother's boss stated, that's the kind of stuff that fed us creatively. It was just so stupid and so low and yet so great.
Yeah, they do seem to kind of revel in the sort of, like, it's really like this ironic appreciation idea, you know? They're like, oh, this is really dumb, and I love it because of that. It's like, oh, yeah, we do that all the time, but maybe it was a less popular idea in 1980.
Exactly.
I know it really emerged in the 90s, but I don't really know.
Devo, maybe just a bit ahead of their time and like loving decay and like and garbage.
Yeah, and even like the beginning of the video says Devo in whip tees.
Whip tees. Yeah, it's all very like on the nose. You got fucking cowboys drinking Budweiser beers while one of the Devo men comes out to whip a cigarette and then the clothes off of this woman. It's like, it's all, I get why people are like, oh my God, like this is terrible. And it is, but it's also, it's very explicitly done to make fun of that being terrible.
Yeah. And like, I mean, there's the part of it where like, there's literal cowboys in here. We kind of talked about how like, there's some idea of satirizing America.
Like, yeah. Americana. Cowboys.
That's like about as much of an American symbol as you can get.
Yeah. You've got a log cabin. You got a cowboys with some blonde women. There's a like your 1950s housewife in the house, and then the mysterious cross-eyed woman.
Yeah, I don't really know what that's all about.
Yeah, that is beyond me. But yeah, you got the fucking like cowboy backdrop. Worth noting, this was made for $15,000. In the year 1980, another music video we've talked about made in the same year, one of the most expensive music videos of all time, Ashes to Ashes by David Bowie, made for, I believe, $582,000 in the same. So that's a 1-to-1 currency ratio of the 15,000 to the 580,000.
Yeah. Yeah. Both equally successful.
Yeah. That's kind of the funny part is I love both of these music videos. Yeah.
I mean, another thing I like about this video, like, the Devo guys come out, and they're so, like, scrawny.
Yeah.
And there's these, like, cowboys in their, like, plaid and hats, and then these, like, skinny guys in their orgone hats, and you're like, oh, shit.
Yeah, with their black, like, tank tops and shorts.
Yeah, and, like, weird face masks. Yeah, it's, like, it's contrast in many ways.
Yeah, it's truly just, like, meant to be insane.
Playing their instruments.
Yeah, well, the one Devo man with the safety goggles comes up to do the whipping.
Yeah.
So they bring out a woman in full garb. She's got a hat on. She's got like a shawl. She's got a dress on. And they put a cigarette in her mouth.
Yeah, she kind of looks, I don't know if this means anything, but she looks like wealthy.
Yeah.
She's got like the long cigarette and like hat. And I don't know if that means anything.
Yeah, I don't know if that is, but yeah, she definitely doesn't look like a poor woman, and she does look distinct from both the cowgirls and the cross-eyed woman.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, apparently, so most of the clothes was taken off using, like, I guess there was a Velcro on the whip, so she wasn't actually getting whipped, or there was strings attached or something. It was just the whip, like, grabbing these strings and pulling them, which then pulled off the clothing.
Yeah, and you can kind of tell, like, just the way
there's a really obvious one when it's a wider shot. I think it's him taking off the shawl, and it's like, okay, yeah, that just dragged it. It didn't whip it off. But the cigarette whip was apparently legitimate.
They actually whipped the cigarette out. That's a close one and very dangerous because
very dangerous
near the face.
Yeah, I guess you could say they whipped it good.
They whipped it good.
And they must have a pro on there, right? Because it cuts to just a close-up of her face. And
true, it might not be the Devo guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, and this is... Yeah, so he just, like, kind of whips. And I guess, like, the imagery of everyone, like, watching and drinking Budweiser's and, like, being a cowboy as this woman gets her clothes whipped off. Surely they had something in mind beyond, like, this is just a way to see a woman be stripped. Somewhat violently.
Yeah. Right?
Like, well, they've got to be commenting on something, right?
They're satirizing this The Dude article.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which, like, is great, and I'm sure they did a good job of it, but if you're satirizing something that nobody fucking knows, it, like, right. It's impossible to delineate from genuine enthusiasm to That's a degree.
True. That's true. Satire is very difficult.
And yeah, in that article, I mean, that The Dude article sounds like it's a real piece of Americana bullshit, right? Yeah, this guy, he was a stunt man, now he lives as a rancher, and he just fucking whips strippers all day. Like,
stuntman to cowboy to literally whipping clothes off, yeah.
Just, it's some bizarro masculine fever dream, right? So,
which kind of those magazines, I think, kind of were. Not that I read.
Yeah, that's 100% what they were. So while he's whipping the woman and taking the clothes off, by the end of the film, or the end of the short music video, I was going to call it a short film, same thing, music video, he's successfully whipped her down to her lingerie, her underwear. Meanwhile, there's like a drama taking place with the cowboys and cowgirls. A beer gets busted open. It gets foamy and spilled everywhere. The cross-eyed woman in the cabin eventually takes aim and shoots a beer can out of one of the cowboys' hands.
Yeah, she's like trying to aim her gun and she's cross-eyed and shows like her not being able to see very well.
Yeah, she's seeing double. She's got two guns, one for each of you.
And then like the cowboy just like goes and like grabs her shoulders.
Bucks her, I think.
And there's like,
because the blonde girl cheers him on. We get weird bits of dialogue,
right,
on the bottom of the screen, and she says, "Ride him, cowboy."
So it, yeah, seems sexual to me.
Meanwhile, we get the mom whipping some whipped cream. It's a lot of whipped cream.
Yeah, she has a very big bowl of whipped cream.
She shows it off. She pulls up like a big fucking ladle full. She's like, check that out.
And then, what else?
We get another shot of the cross-eyed woman and the dude. And it looks like they're fucking. She's got her leg up. And then he jumps back down on her.
Yeah, she like pulls him down. He's like holding her foot. Yeah.
And then eventually, it seems like the official music video here cuts off at the end because it pulls out. The housewife says, "Oh, that Alan." And then the guy, we see that it's been on a TV this whole time. So we're pulling back into the real world. And a guy says, "Whip it." And then it ends because it's supposed to say something more. But
I actually didn't see the very end.